One of the most unusual singers at Motown was Liz Lanz, who had three singles on the Gordy label, and I think she had one that was scheduled for the Divinity label. Liz had an amazing five-octave range, and it's actually her singing the high C notes on Mary Wells's Oh Little Boy, What Did You Do to Me? Her third and final Gordy single was Midnight Johnny, which she's backed by the Temptations, who had just broke with The Way You Do the Things You Do. The record was released as Gordy 7030 in 1964.
My name is Elizabeth L. Hoffman. Oh, I'm out of the ghetto, I'm out of Harlem, on 26th Street, Millennium Avenue, 317, from the ghetto. My foster mother, who was the maid to our family, is how I got into the holiness situation. She was the maid to the family. Grandmother was the mother and a disciplinarian. And you couldn't sing, you couldn't do nothing but sing Ave Maria. Okay, I'm Catholic. At least that's what I was brought up in. But I'm really just a plain old person that serves the Ten Commandments. I follow those religiously. I had a happy, happy childhood. Happy. I was singing in churches, doing concerts. My mother took me. I had a wonderful childhood. We worked all up New England states, New York City, upstate New York. I did all the concerts, worked with everybody, Madison Square Garden, everybody. Worked with everybody you think about. My best feeling in life is that I had a talent that I didn't understand. My talent, when I realize I have six octaves, and I realize that's that blessing God gave me, I just, you know, I used to think I was real bad, because I didn't understand this talent, you know. I just didn't understand it. I wanted to get up on the bicycle or ride the swing, stand up in there, double dutch, you know, that's what I want. I didn't know about this talent, but my mother, my foster mother, Rose Lanz, who was the maid to our family, she was a church-going Charlotte, North Carolina person, so she kept me in the Church of God Christ, and that's how I got all that. Whatever I got now, that's what I got now. I got it from mother. I got it from mother's husband, who was the minister. I called him Black Papa because he was very mean and ugly. But his name was Reverend John J. Lanz Jr. And that's where I got the Church of God in Christ, the holiness in me, see, from them. From Catholicism, from Catholic Church of God in Christ, all in like within a couple of years of one another. And I'm a little child like this, you know, I'm wondering, oh Jesus, will you ever let me get to see 18 or 21 so I get out of this? And that's what I did.
One man's poison is another.
It was a white man, his name was Elli Wagner, W-A-G-N-E-R. And he owned a cemetery called Mount Holiness. And for some reason, he was, I don't know what, but he spearheaded talent, raw talent. He heard me singing on a radio station every Sunday morning with a group called Anna Tuell Gospel Singers. And I was the featured vocalist, and he heard me. So he was the one, Elli Wagner, who owned the cemetery where my mother is. Foster mother is living right now, Mount Holiness Cemetery in Butler, New Jersey. He was the one that paid my first initial $35 or $40 pay for you learning to sing. My coach, my tutor, okay, my coach, my singing coach. He paid for those for me to be taught to train, but I guess he realized that, I don't know, but he knew I had a whole lot of talent in me, so it wasn't really too much that anybody could do for me, because I already had talent, because God gave me that. I already had 6 octaves. I just didn't know how to truly channel it all the way. So he made 25 to 30 lessons for me to get private individual tutoring for my voice to perfect it. They found out that I was a natural breather, so they didn't have to teach me how to breathe, because in order to sing, you have to breathe, truly. You have to inhale, exhale, and know how to ease that note out and how to bring it back. It's all in breath control. Oh, that's real simple. What's his name? You know, I lived in Harlem, and it was a Baby Grand. I'm sure you hit to that Baby Grand. Well, they heard me. And see, I was underage, so mother had to go with me. I started working at the Baby Grand. It was Nipsey Russell, Red Fox. They were the openers, so they took me under their wing. Nipsey Russell, Red Fox, Sarah Vaughan. Who else? There's so many more. They took me under their wings and showed me the ropes of show business. I switched over from the gospel field because I didn't like it, because it was too raunchy. I switched from that to pop music, as it was called in those days. And they heard me. And see, I was doing the Apollo every week. Okay, so they heard me, and they just took me under, Sarah Vaughan, they just took me under their wings, and just, they taught me the ropes of show business. I promise you. I got hooked up with a manager called Joe Basik Sr., a thug, and his son, Joe Basik Jr. Joe Basik Sr. was the one in Manhattan in Harlem that booked all of your acts like Mahalia Jackson, Highway QC, Soul Stirrers, Dixie Hummingbird. He booked all those folks. Huge, huge shows. Then he started managing me. Okay. And of course, I was on every show and as the opening act. I got sneezed, wait a bit. Anyway, Joe Basik managed all of your huge performers. Clara Ward's, Dixie Hummingbirds, Highway QC, Soulster, Sam Cooke. That's what I came up in. So he booked me at Carnegie Hall. Mahalia Jackson is my godmother. I call her Mama Haley. She's my godmother. She was the featured attraction at Carnegie Hall. I was 15 years old. That was my coming out, so to say, debutante. That was my coming out, being introduced into the world, okay? I did a song called Somebody Bigger Than You and I, one of my favorite songs. And I received a 15-minute standing ovation from the audience at Carnegie Hall. And I also won at the same time the Mahalia Jackson Award. You know, they had the awards around, see who would sing, they come to Carnegie Hall and whoever is the best, they win. Well, that's what happened to me. Not that I'm the best, but evidently I won. Okay, Mahalia Jackson lived on 83rd in Indiana in Chicago. So was I in Chicago. I lived there for 8 years. And I became like her daughter, because she knew me from Joe Basik. He was managing her, but he was no earthly good. because he took all our money, but he didn't take Mahalia's money, because Haley wasn't going to sing nothing unless you gave her all her money, and she sat in the audience till you gave her all her money, then she'd go up on stage and sing. Don't believe, she taught me the ropes. That's how that happened. When I won that $1,500 award from Mahalia Jackson's award at Carnegie Hall, that opened up the doors for me for everybody. I was with the king, We Shall Overcome. I'm the one that did that, We Shall Overcome. Every time you hear that song, that's me singing it, Liz Lanz. I was a teller at Citizens Trust Company, a bank teller at Citizens Trust Company down on Auburn Avenue in Atlanta, Georgia. I was a new girl in the bank. Had pretty legs, pretty feet, dressed my butt off, and was intelligent. Well, S.C.L.C., as it was called in those days, they used to bring, they do this to all new bank tellers. They used to bring all the money that's all rolled up and full of gum and wood and candy and all. They would give it to the newcomers in the bank, thought they were doing something. So I handled all of SCLC, Southern Christian Leadership Conference's monies. And King would bring it in. That's how we met. Somebody told him, either Milton Gates that owned the Gates drugstore or what, somebody told him that I was one heck of a vocalist. He came to my cage and asked me, Sister Lance, I said, don't call me no Sister Lance, I'm not your sister. He chuckled. He said, I want you to understand that you have a melodious voice, and I want you to go on the Freedom Festival with us. I told him this, I ain't marching, and ain't nobody gonna throw nothing in my face, because if you hit me, I'm gonna hit you back. So if you want me to march, forget it. As I was on the road, Berry Gordy called me back into Detroit, sent the limo, the plane, sent the limo. I went back to Detroit. Berry is about, maybe it's about 3:30, quarter four in the morning, in the studio, Hitsville. He wrote a song for the president called May What He Lived For Live. May what he lived for live. May what he strived for live. Okay, so I had never heard the song, nothing. Played the track, I read the words off a sheet of paper, you tell. He stood for it's unbelievable what I did. Finished that song, May What He Lived For Live, that was minted in gold, 24 karat gold, and sent to the White House to Mrs. Jacqueline Onassis-Kennedy. And she wrote me a letter back thanking me, a thank you note. It was linen paper, about that tall, about that wide, black borders. And it was handwritten. It was not no typewriter, it was handwritten, written, thanking me. Ooh, you know I'm something. Ooh, I am something. Still have it. Ain't fitting to sell it. What they try. Her name is Jacqueline Bouvier Kennedy Onassis. I got a handwritten note from her.
One man's poison is
hell. It just goes back to all the way back there. Back there, back there. I am not number one. I have never been a booty kisser. And I've always been an independent person and you know, and served Jesus. Unless it made sense between me and Jesus, it didn't make no sense. And so I have nothing to do with you. Okay, here's a Pillsbury Doe white man from London, England. Acton, England. A-C-T-O-N. Whatever the rest of that is. And he looks like the original Pillsbury Doe person, but he's just very tall. But he has this kind of opinion of performers that all you have to do is get them whatever that it is that they like and get them high and buzzed up. Pardon me, and you can get anything you want out of them. Well, I'm a rebel. I'm a beer drinker, and I don't need no performer, no person from across the road, across the water, to come and think that he just give me what I need and I'll sing what he wants me to sing. It don't work like that with me. But Ian Levine has, and I'm saying it now, no respect for a performer. None of them. Black, white, green, or yellow, or purple, or in between orange. He has no respect for you. He just wants you, he just has all these monies, and he's got a dream, and he records everybody, and then he takes it back over to England, pardon me, and sends everything to all the other parts of Europe, and you don't get 1 cent worth of royalties from it. You see where I'm coming from? So that Ian Levine can kiss my monkey's backside. And one of these days, I'm going to tell him, and he is going to give me my monies. To this very day, I have not gotten 1 cent, not received 1 cent. And I got tracking sheets of where my material is like number one, number one, number one. I ain't got no number one money. That Pillsbury Doe, Ian Levine, I'm gonna sue his ass the very first chance I get. I promise you. I ain't forgot about him, cause he owes me hundreds of thousands of dollars. Cause I'd like to stick an ice pick up his dope Pillsbury butt backside and let all the blubber drain out his ass. He did me wrong, is what he did. He did me wrong. He did me wrong. He brought all of us up to Detroit, Michigan to do the Detroit sound. He gave us all $1,500. That's it! And round trip transportation and the hotel tab that we stayed in. I stayed in the suite, yes I did. Ian Levine, a Pillsbury Doe son of a biscuit. I'm gonna see that Negro one day. Okay, it was a lady named Bertha Goldberg. And her right gut husband, Sammy Goldberg. But it was his wife that did so much for me. He didn't even know it. He was so rotten. I'm telling you, and he was my manager. He was so rotten. Let me tell you what he did. Y'all ain't gonna believe this. I didn't believe it till I saw it. His mother, he's from Jersey, New Jersey. His mother died. Sammy Goldberg's mother died. That's married to Bertha, who had all the money. He took up an offering at his mother's funeral home. This is my manager now. And he took all the monies that he collected for to bury his mother in the ground. And went back to LA, California with know if his mother got in the ground or not, don't nobody know. This was my manager. Now you know I didn't have a chance. If you do that to your mother, what you gonna do to me? And I ain't no way related to you. You understand? This is the book, Naked Truth. Y'all think I'm lying? This was my manager. And Bertha was his wife. Bertha and I were like so. In fact, she's the one that gave me my first poodle. Okay? Lived in Baldwin Hills, California. You know I'm not lying. But her husband, a black Jew, he took all the money he raised for his mother's funeral to put her in the ground. Got on the next jet out to California. Don't know if the mother ever got buried, darling. Do not know it. Now, that's what I have. some of what I have encountered in life. Is that not despicable?
Oh, well, yeah.
You take, you ain't got enough money to bury your mother. You take up all everybody giving you money. You gonna take that money, go elsewhere across the world, 3,000 miles across the world, and spend that money. You was a sorry son of a biscuit. That's all there is to it. And that was my manager. And when he did that, look, he had us on the road, and he wanted me to stay in with 5 men in one room. Said, you done lost. I ain't gonna tell you what I said, but it starts with an F and it ends with a G. Mine. If you think I'm going to stay up in this room with all these men that I do not know, but that's the way he did. He had us on the road and he put us, look. Some of the shit that has happened to me. I ended up working, he said for me to come. The only thing I had going for me was his wife, Bertha. He said for me to come to Los Angeles. I came to Los Angeles to come to the airport. I'm there, then he's supposed to get, he had the gigs for me. So I ended up working in his wife's cleaners. That's how I know how to. Clean clothes, okay, dry clean clothes. I ended up working in his wife's cleaning store. So I did that for about 3 months, and then I got on the phone, I called my husband, I said, Parker, you, Tommy Brown, you send me a ticket, get away from this son of a biscuit. If you don't, I'm gonna kill everything that's up here. You better get me out of here. He sent me a first-class ticket from Los Angeles to Atlanta, daggone Georgia. I can't stay around a person that you take an offering for your mother to bury her, and then you take the money and run Venezuela with it, and you don't know what has happened to your mother. I said, that cannot be a manager of mine. The only thing that saved me was my husband. He knew I meant what I said. You need to send me a ticket. Let me get out of here. And he did the same damn day. And Bertha took me to the airport where she gave me one of her poodles. That's how I got into the poodle idiom, Apricot. She had like 5 or 6. You ain't gonna believe me when I tell you this. You gonna think she's lying. I was working the Etc. Club in Beverly Hills, California. It's ETC Club. It's one of those things like that. And I was there. And of course, all your artists and your choreographers and your nasty, negative people, everybody was there to see if they could find fault. I've had beautiful times. Beautiful performers, some not so nice, some magnificent. All I want to do now is get my music out there and say, hey, hey, y'all, I'm still alive, and this is still Liz Lands. God didn't give me this talent to let it go to waste, and I'm not about to do that, as we're already doing, because I wouldn't know you, thanks to you, had it not been for Nina, Red Taylor, Crystal Ann Graham, I never would have known you. So it was a reason for me to get my behind and go for a place that I despise. It was a reason. I met you through family. So as far as I'm concerned, that's all there is.
Yeah.